The National Weather Service has issued a blizzard warning.
Watching the explosion of a major snowstorm.
Roads are bad out there tonight.
You don't have to travel. Don't get out on the road.
It is the Daytona International Speedway where the action is today.
And you're going to see it from flag to flag. The winter of 79 hit the Northeast in a big way.
Well, the tension's really been building here this week.
Sunny South? Well, it was far from it today.
We have a serious weather condition. Nothing like this has happened here in more than 15 years.
Hollywood scripted today's race.
Wild and woolly affair.
Just an incredibly dramatic finish.
Nobody believed it would happen.
Welcome to the 21st annual Daytona 500.
If you go by the idea that every era in time is defined by something, then how in the world do you define an era in time like the 1970s in America?
The state of the union is not good.
The 60s are easier. They were the decade when everything changed. When the story was about people questioning things, fighting for things. But the aftermath, the 70s, ended up being more about uncertainty than any answers. More about confusion surrounding what was supposed to come next.
Well, we were coming out of the Vietnam War.
You can climb a mountain. You can swim the sea. You can jump into the fire.
Were dissatisfied with the government because we had not told the truth. We had wars in the Middle East. The hostages were taken by the Iranians. The apartheid in South Africa. So there were some massive changes taking place.
The culture seemed to be growing more disjointed with every passing year. And there was more that was breaking apart than coming together. But looking back, maybe that left plenty of room for something new to show up unexpectedly and grab everyone's attention. Maybe that meant a perfect storm could change something like sports forever. As the world turned in some new directions in the 70s, if you took even one look at the little world of NASCAR, you'd see things there were no different than anywhere else.
We may be from the South, but we had TVs, so we knew what people dressed like. That part of the culture did seep in to the sport. You saw guys, their hair got a little longer. You saw guys with sideburns, with the Elvis sideburns. My father had a Fu Manchu, the bell bottoms, the leisure suits, and the nice flowery polyester shirts that went under the leisure suits. A lot of that become part of what the sport was.
If I could be born in as a race car driver in any era, it would be the 70s.
Gentlemen, start your engines!
The cars were so attractive, and you could see a Ford and a Chevy and notice it right away. Tons of great characters in the sport back then, a lot of great personalities.
Good old Southern boys like Richard Petty, the king of the stockers.
Everything about that era just seems very, very exciting to me.
Just a good old boy, never meaning no harm. Beats all you never saw, been in trouble with the law since the day they was born.
Joe, you look mad and dirty and disappointed.
In the 70s, the drivers were not eloquent.
Well, you're out of the race, huh?
We were considered to be rednecks.
And I'll tell you one thing, I believe in frogs. I'm going to get me a whole bushel of them, I think.
And kind of backward.
Almost lost the damn thing!
The culture was more of a blue-collar. Folks that they grew up going to the dirt tracks. And so it was a cult following.
It was still a Southern sport and a Southeastern sport and a grassroots sport. This was still a God and country and you know, the Bible Belt and that type of sport.
Well, Ned, you know, I just want to thank the good Lord for a good, safe race today.
It was based in the South. Most of its events were in the South.
Most all the drivers were from the Southeast.
And there wasn't a lot of national media attention.
And I doubt if you'd ever see NASCAR on the front page of a sports section. I had to justify every year why we had a motorsports editor. And they wanted to know, why are we following this particularly Southern sport? This is a bunch of good old boys down here racing. Why should the nation care?
The sports the nation cared about had become big business for television networks, but they didn't exactly view NASCAR as a showcase.
At that time, there were three buyers of sports for national telecast: ABC, NBC, and CBS.
It was still Major League Baseball, it was still football, and it was college football. It was whatever the networks wanted to put out there and tell you those are the sports you need to pay attention to.
So if we got a mention on a network sportscast, we were thrilled.
NASCAR was pretty low in terms of priority. Some of the races were being carried by ABC, but they were being carried on a tape delay. They would integrate the race into their wide world of sports.
We've been doing, you know, spot deals, ABC Wide World of Sports show 15 minutes between marble shooting and wrestling or something.
Now, for the Men's Downhill World Cup Skiing Championship.
Frankly, we didn't know if there was an audience outside of the Southeast for NASCAR racing.
Well, here I am in famous Darlington downtown. The beer seems to have done them a lot of good. They're very relaxed, they're enjoying the sun, and I think really they are also enjoying the motor racing.
And so we all knew for us to take it to another level, we had to change. We had to make some big changes. We were trying to take the sport from the backwoods to Wall Street.
NASCAR may have been considered a regional sport. Bill France Sr.'s mind, it was anything but. When I first went to work for that guy, did you know by the year 2000, we're going to be part of major sports in the United States?
NASCAR was Big Bill France. And while Bill may have been the face, Bill Jr., though, was the one that had more of the vision for the future.
Some of the other sports we caught up with, to grow the sport, we had to get more out of the Southeast. It's a big country, there's 50 states. We had to move around in some of the other areas.
It was Bill France Jr.'s goal to take what was a regional Southern sport that his father had founded and make it national.
Bill Jr. knew that down the road, it was not only going to be the people that were sitting in the seats, but it was going to be the people who were going to sit at home and maybe come across it and go, wow.
But we weren't sure that we could get the broadcast, the television, to show the sport, and we needed to do that.
In the late 1970s, NASCAR was poised for growth, but it needed a major push. And as the decade came to a close, it was, how do we take this to the next level? What can we do?
In the mid-1970s, a few tastes of national television exposure were exciting to the France family. But NASCAR's owners weren't sure what came next. And that's when an old radio man stepped in.
Well, I grew up in radio, and I ended up down in Daytona. France Sr. became my big mentor.
Ken Squire was from Vermont, of all places, and he'd met Bill France Sr. while working for the Motor Racing Radio Network in the 60s.
That was where I really got the roots of how to do the job and to make sure that the public got the word and the right kind of word to keep them intrigued and fascinated.
Auto racing and radio was a perfect mix. And the reason is because you could paint word pictures where the fan listening on the radio at home would feel like they were sitting there watching it unfold.
You can see this car, number 11, Cale Yarborough, like an angry, ruffled grouse as it comes out of this fourth turn. The back end just chattering. It's an angry car, and it's an angry driver. Richard Petty and A.J. Foyt switch positions, dancing down into the first turn. Some beautiful driving by those two.
He not only made us recognize the drivers, but care about them as people, respect them as athletes, and realize that they were heroes.
From the Charlotte Motor Speedway in North Carolina, I'm Ken Squire, and welcome to the 19th running of the...
Squire began calling races on TV in the mid-70s and came to believe that the sport he'd fallen in love with could have a much wider appeal, even in a country that sometimes seemed less and less united every day.
America wanted heroes, real heroes they could believe in.
His idea was to introduce America to those heroes in a bold way by broadcasting NASCAR's biggest race, the Daytona 500, live from start to finish.
Ken Squire had the vision that this would work. He also, frankly, very important, he had Bill France's ear.
With Bill Sr.'s blessing, Squire scheduled a meeting with CBS Sports in early 1978 and decided to bring along a sidekick, a hard-charging young driver by the name of Darrell Waltrip.
Coming to turn three, two more turns to go. Richard Petty, Darrell Waltrip. Oh! Petty has got the lead, and there comes Waltrip. They're coming to the finish line.
Waltrip was really the grace of God to get him at that time because he had the mouth and he was funny.
You got any comment? Ain't you got anything to say?
You don't have to get bossy.
You Yankees are all alike. Yeah. Back to the tower.
They needed someone that could talk and could promote the sport and could sell it.
Turned out Waltrip could sell as well as he could drive. CBS wanted to make a deal. But that was just the first step. Because when Neil Pilson and the Frances opened up negotiations in Daytona Beach, there was a long list of details to work out.
Whether it would be a five-year deal, a three-year deal, exactly how much we would pay, what the provisions were in case it did get rain delayed or rained out.
And then there was another sticking point, Bill Sr.'s demands for a blackout on NASCAR's home turf.
The blackout in the Southeast probably took hours and hours of my negotiating time.
Guys like Bill Sr., they lived and died by the gate, by the ticket count.
Bill was insistent that he had to protect his gate. The tradition of going to a track was so ingrained with NASCAR fans. We didn't think it would be a problem, but Bill insisted that we agree, I think, to a five-state, maybe even a seven-state blackout.
NASCAR's future had come face-to-face with its past, and Pilson realized that to introduce the rest of America to NASCAR, for the moment, he'd have to give in on the Southeast.
So now I get to day three. I rebooked my motel one more day, and I'm sitting talking to Jill Jr., and a great big hand claps me on the shoulder, and I look around, and it's Bill Sr. And Bill Sr. says, "Neil, I think we have a deal."
To celebrate, Big Bill invited Pilson to partake in some of Daytona Beach's finest cuisine, the local Steak and Shake.
That's a little counter-type restaurant about a half a mile down from the track. And Bill said, "I'll pick up the tab." In my recollection, it was $6.73.
The deal was announced on May 16, 1978. CBS would broadcast the 1979 Daytona 500 live, flag to flag.
I think everybody was just really excited about it. When they said it was going to be live, that was a big step forward for everybody.
You immediately knew this was going to be a transition point. This was going to be a pivot point for the future of auto racing. All of us kind of got excited, but then thought, how are they going to do this?
The 1979 Daytona 500 was 2 weeks after Super Bowl XIII. CBS would be sending the same technical crew to both events, with a young producer and director in charge at the race.
They gave us a strange collection of people. Two young men really hadn't left this studio. Michael Pearl, Bobby Fishman.
Bob Fishman and myself were sort of a team. We produced and directed the NFL Today.
I had experience, but not on this scale. I was mainly at that time a studio guy. I was thinking, boy, this is huge. This is career-making or career-breaking.
David Hobbs was selected as my colleague in the top side.
David was a Formula One driver. He had this lovely accent.
But what a race at the moment. It's absolutely incredible.
They went out and hired Brock Yates There wasn't a better writer on motorsports.
They do a lot of hunting and fishing around here. Grow some tomatoes and some apples. But they also build Grand National stock cars.
Ned Jarrett was our link to the NASCAR audience.
And in 1965, I had took one of the hardest licks of my career and almost broke my neck when I hit this wall.
Marianne Bunch came along. She was an addition. But that cadre that was in the top side of that to do the actual on-air stuff were people that truly cared.
Hiring announcers was easy compared to the network's biggest challenge, broadcasting a three-hour race live around a 2.5-mile track.
I'm sure there were people out there hoping we'd fail. I'm sure there were people out there thinking we were crazy.
We had, two trucks, and we had, I don't know how many cameras we had, but I know they kept saying we got a lot of cameras. They'd done football games with, you know, a handful of cameras, and the wiring amounts to a few thousand feet. And suddenly, you know, they got Daytona for the 2.5-mile track. I mean, they got miles of cable. I mean, they'd never had this much cable at any event.
And once the logistics were mapped out, CBS had to find ways to convey the speed of the cars on television. One of their first ideas, putting a camera right on the track.
The main concern was, why are you guys putting a man on a camera down low where there's only like a 3-foot wall separating him from any danger? First of all, finding a cameraman to do it, you know, you've got to be a little nuts. And we found the guy. His name was Joe Sakota, and he was very brave to do that because if a car broke away, you know, he basically had to duck down behind the wall and just forget manning his camera. He also had to wear a motorcycle helmet.
Their next innovation would put fans even closer to the action, a camera inside a race car.
A lot of the drivers were concerned about the weight. I believe it was about 35, 37 pounds in those days, and Benny Parsons agreed to do it.
There you see the Race Vision camera. We'll be showing you live pictures here on CBS.
Meanwhile, the collection of characters that CBS would be introducing to the nation was filled with both new stars on the rise and iconic NASCAR names.
Starting the 1979 season, I don't think people knew quite what to expect. For many, many years, there had been these duels between Richard Petty and David Pearson. They had finished 1-2 63 times. And although we didn't know it at the time, that era had just ended. They would never finish 1-2 again in another race.
1978 had been the worst year of Richard Petty's career. He failed to win a race for the first time since 1959. And he'd also found himself struggling with his health, even as he tried to put a charming face on the problems.
Where are you hurt?
Well, busted a couple of 3 ribs up in Michigan, and they still give me trouble. They've done all right for a while, and then they finally got to me.
But late that year, after the season, the pain grew too hard to bear, and Petty was forced to undergo major surgery.
At the end of 78, I'd been having stomach problems and ulcers all.
Eventually, the acid had eaten through, and his ulcers had gotten so bad they had to remove like 30 or 40% of his stomach. He went from 210 or 15 pounds to look like 165 pounds.
My doctor in Greensboro finds out I'm in Daytona running. He calls up and tells the doctors down there, don't let that guy on the racetrack. He just had an operation 4 weeks ago. We didn't pay no attention.
Cale Yarborough wasn't likely to be paying much attention either. In his mind, there was no reason to.
Cale was a little tough guy. You know, he wasn't really friendly with very many of the guys.
I tried to drive him just as hard as I could run every lap, and that's the way I did my whole career.
Cale was an absolute bulldog. And we had Bobby Allison out there as well, who'd had huge run-ins with Cale before. There was a big wreck that Cale caused at Rockingham, where Bobby narrowly escaped death. So you knew that the Allison family was not gonna take any guff from Cale Yarborough.
Bobby and Donnie Allison were two of NASCAR's most popular drivers. They're not equally successful.
From the driving standpoint, Bobby was always just a lap ahead of his brother.
Bobby had won Daytona in 78, but he saw his kid brother as one of the biggest threats in the field.
Donnie didn't race as much as I did, but when he showed up, he was a great competitor.
The green flag is out, and Donnie Allison floors the throttle.
Donnie only ran a couple hundred races in his entire career, but he won 10 of them.
And in 1979, it looked like Daytona might be his last best chance to escape his brother's shadow.
78, we ended in really a good situation for 79, and we were ready to go.
The field was stacked with stars and stories for a landmark day at Daytona. Now it was time for everything they couldn't control.
The winter of 79 hit the big way today.
We are watching the explosion of a major snowstorm in the Northeast.
Our people must remain in their homes. Virtually every roadway in this state is impassable.
Rain and snow today. This is the day the East Coast gets the heavy snow.
Nothing like this has happened here in more than 15 years, and the city was unprepared.
The storm crippled the area, closing airports, clogging highways, and just about shutting down some of the big cities.
So much snow on the streets, we're wondering where to put it.
On Sunday, February 18th, 1979, much of the eastern United States woke up trapped in their homes.
The East Coast is snowed in. From Jacksonville, Florida, to Maine, the whole East Coast was in the biggest snowstorm it ever had, probably ever.
The only good thing about the storm was that it came on the weekend when most people could stay at home and out of the weather.
Nobody up north could get out.
So nobody could go anywhere, so they had to sit there at home and watch that stupid race.
People weren't going anywhere. We're gonna put something on TV that's gonna last 4.5, 5 hours. Yeah, I'll stay here. Where can I go? I can't go anywhere outside.
And you gotta figure, it's 1979, you didn't have all the TV stations. You had, you know, three or four different ABC, CBS, and NBC, and that was it.
We saw that we had the ability to have people at least test the waters of auto racing.
But weather was also a factor at Daytona, where organizers had been praying for months for clear skies on race day. They didn't get them.
The sunny south, well, it was far from it today. Rain pelted the southeast.
I wanted to throw up. It was raining. Horrible weather. Now what are we going to do?
We were pretty sure we wouldn't get that puppy in.
You know, I said, now this is really ironic because we're going to have a live TV, and we may not get to start this race.
The most concerned person was my boss. He said, we don't have to televise this race if it rains, do we? I said, yes, we do. He said, well, we can leave and go to some other event, can't we? I said, no, we're kind of stuck with this event. We have to stay with it unless they cancel.
But the Franz family wasn't about to give up on what they were hoping would be the biggest, most important day in their sports history.
Rumor has it that Bill Sr. extended his authority just a bit, went up on the roof of the grandstand, held out his arms, looked up, and said, enough rain, let's hold it, stop raining.
Did he go on the rooftop and do the Moses thing? I don't know. He might have. I'm sure he said some prayers, and they were answered.
Within about 20 minutes, it stopped raining, and it began to look like we would, in fact, have a race.
Live from Daytona Beach, Florida, a CBS Sports special, the 1979 Daytona 500.
I decided it would be best that we came on the air showing this is what the weather was like an hour and a half ago, and Kenley put words to it to dramatize.
Today, race cars capable of over 200 miles per hour take on a far more romantic image. Welcome to the 21st annual Daytona 500.
They came on the air at noon Eastern, and behind the scenes, the push was on to start the race on time soon after.
Bill France Sr. came into the drivers' meeting, and he told the competitors, he said, there's a lot of TV money in the purse. The TV money only gets paid out if the race runs on schedule.
With that kind of money up for grabs, NASCAR and the Frances are going to make damn sure that this race runs.
I'm Ken Squire. This is David Hobbs. The drivers have all been introduced. They are now going to their automobiles, and we should be getting a start at just about the time predicted.
It rained, 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 and right up to the time we got into the cars, and they're saying, get in your cars. We say, you people lost your mind. We can't go out there. The track's wet.
All right, 21, let's go with them.
Gentlemen, stop now.
vengeance has been given. For racing fans, this is such sweet thunder.
Surrounding the cars was a crowd of more than 100,000. While most of the rest of the South would get to watch it on TV after all.
At the last minute, when the race tickets were being sold handily, Bill said, we'll lift the blackout for those states other than Florida.
Bill, this is not your usual Daytona 500. Does the rain and the weather that we've had have some effect upon this?
Well, it hasn't had any effect on the crowd. So the only problem that we've had was trying to get the track dried off.
They didn't have the jet dryers, anything like that. They relied on the cars going around the track under caution to dry the track.
Bill France had agreed in the contract with the TV people, the race will start at 1 o'clock. You guess what? At 1 o'clock, the green flag dropped on the 1979 Daytona 500.
I went up into the control tower when they were running those caution laps, and the tension was palpable.
The report from the drivers out there is that the track is still very damp.
When there was damp weather, they would always take one of the top drivers, and we used to call it, you send the rabbit out. Go out there, take a look at it, tell us what it feels like.
Well, nobody wanted to do it. You know, everybody said it was wet, and I'm still young and dumb. You know, it didn't look that wet to me. And so I said, I'll do it.
It looks as if Darrell Waltrip is going to go out and run some hard laps in front of the pack.
Now, I manned a lap, and I said, that track's great. We're ready to go.
That's all they needed to hear. If America's watching, that's enough of that. Let's get to some real action.
All right, let's go. It'd be one lap to go when they get here.
15 laps have been completed. Still be getting green this time.
Come on, Chip, let them out.
And so after all those caution laps, round and round, they dropped the green flag officially in the 500 starts.
It's a typical Daytona 500 race. It's flat out. Nobody's lifting for anything.
Donnie Allison goes out in front, Baker dropping to second.
With the sun starting to poke through the clouds, the track was improving with every lap. The infield was another story.
The Allison brothers are going to go at it.
We're racing each other pretty close, and I feel like I got bumped by somebody, and it got me out of shape a little bit.
Oh! Spinning. He gets hit by his brother. He's all the way around.
That wet grass now incredibly slippery.
It had rained all night, and it wasn't nothing but water and mud on the infield. I lost control of the car.
I don't know who ran into who back in the back, but I know I got ran into.
Meanwhile, as far as CBS was concerned, they couldn't have planned the wreck better if they tried.
I knew we could do this, because it happened right there on the camera that we were on at the time. That's luck. But luck gives you the confidence to say, we can do this.
They ran over each other, but they were all able to continue.
You know, it was one of those deals that said, okay, I kind of marked them people off. You know, who am I running with? Who have I got to beat now? Because we done eliminated two or three of the better cars.
You look back and say, hey, that's installment one of something that's going to be really good.
Three of the front runners were now laps down. The 79 Daytona 500 was wide open.
And here it comes, a charge to the green flag. Live, the Daytona 500 on CBS with A.J. Foyt. Neil Bonnet in second, Richard Petty rambling in third.
As the 1979 Daytona 500 sped towards its finish, the voice of Ken Squire was America's guide.
That day, he was like a maestro.
They thunder into turn number one, like a giant ballet. Look at this jam session for the lead.
Look at those cars kissing that wall with nobody giving at all.
Covering a city block a second.
If you could bottle up Ken Squire and David Hobbs and have that forever, we wouldn't have nothing to worry about when it comes to broadcasting races.
Oh, tacked on the wall in turn four.
Spinning, Harry Gant out of control at number 12. Hit the wall. Gant goes back into traffic.
Meanwhile, on the track, a series of spectacular crashes and disheartening mechanical failures have put the entire field on edge.
What's the problem?
Too many cautions. We fouled all the plugs out of the cautions.
A very, very displeased young man in this race car.
The CBS telecast seemed to have the track covered from every angle. High, low, and inside the 27 car with Benny Parsons.
And there you are in the passenger seat right beside A.J. Foyt down the 3,100-foot backstretch.
Terrible view because his windshield looked like it had oil all over it, but we got a great view for several laps from a vantage point that we had never seen before.
It spazzed out all the time, but when they needed it to work, the thing was working.
He closes on Jeff Bodine. Here comes Benny Parsons into first place. You were with him as he takes the lead.
29-year-old Jeff Bodine was one of the seven rookies in the field. Another was a kid out of Kannapolis, North Carolina, by the name of Dale Earnhardt.
He got in Rod Osterlund's car, and it was yellow and blue. You could really see the thing stick out, and he stuck it out.
Earnhardt, now there's the kid to watch.
Even at that young, raw time in his career, he seemed to have a real good understanding of what he was doing.
Earnhardt, not intimidated.
Made a lot of good moves during the race and had himself in position to try to battle for the win.
He was a nobody, and he's a 27-year-old, finally getting his shot in the Daytona 500, and all of a sudden, he's up there leading laps, and in fact, the first time Dale Earnhardt takes the lead, they're not even sure if he's on the lead lap or not.
We're checking now to see if Earnhardt is that lap down. Now they're rechecking and scoring. Earnhardt is the leader.
But Earnhardt's turn atop the leaderboard would turn out to be short-lived.
The Daytona 500 could be won by Dale Earnhardt.
Not if Donnie Allison has his way. He takes it away from the kid.
142 laps after his crash early in the race, Donnie Allison had climbed all the way back.
My car actually drove better after the wreck than it did before the wreck.
And as Allison broke away, he had a familiar shadow. Cale Yarborough was just inches behind.
We've seen a lot of tumultuous finishes here in Daytona.
There's a 15-second interval up in front. There's Donnie Allison. There's the two-time winner, Cale Yarborough.
And then the second group was Richard Petty, Darrell Waltrip, and A.J. Foyt.
Donnie and Cale, he got so far ahead of us, couldn't even see him.
They are 15 seconds down.
So we knew we was racing for third.
And I thought, I'm going to ride this thing out. I'm going to get me a top five. I'm in Fat City.
The story told itself at that point. This was going to be a dramatic finish.
Millions of snowbound viewers had never seen anything like it. None of them were changing the channel now.
You're sitting there, and you only got three channels to scroll through. There it was. There was the race. It was one of the few sporting events on that day. It's great TV.
A shallow lead for Donnie Allison. Cale stays there, moves in again.
I'm staying on the leaders. The racing is great, and you're staying on those guys. They're coming off of turn four, heading to the straightaway for the white flag, and I'm on camera two. Ready three, take three.
The white flag is out, one lap to go.
Going into the turn two, ready four, take four. Camera five, I want you wide, ready to push in, take five, and push.
For some reason, I looked in the mirror in the corner. I never did that. And I see him going down. You have all the room you want outside. You're not coming under me off the corner. That's when we hit the door.
Where will Cale make his move? He comes to the inside. Donnie Allison throws the block. Cale hits him. He slides. Donnie Allison slides. They get ahead.
I don't know whether to say I was mad or what. The third time I should have won the Daytona 500, I ain't won.
All the film showed that Donnie just ran me completely off the racetrack. I lost control of the car. I never turned back into him. I never tried to wreck him.
They slide down to the inside. They're out of it.
We're in the press box. We had monitors, and you're watching this, and all of a sudden the two leaders are down. They're in the grass.
Now, neither of these guys are going to finish, so where's third place? Who's third?
Who is going to win it? Coming down, third place. They're coming around for the finish between A.J. Foyt and Richard Petty.
I just remember looking at the screen and going, find the leaders. Let's see who's winning this race.
However, I don't know where Richard Petty is.
Third, fourth, and fifth are 15 to 18 seconds back.
Buddy Arrington had the same colors as Petty's, blue and red. Initially, I took a shot thinking it was Petty.
I saw that come up and I thought, oh my heart. That's when we started selling the race from the booth.
Ken was pleading with me, and if it wasn't for Ken, hey, that may have been a career ender.
They're still up in turns three and four. The Dodgers are up in turns three and four.
And as we start down into the third turn, you look off in the infield over there, down on the bottom of the track, and there sits the 11 and the one.
Wrecked.
Now it is serious.
After 499 miles, Daytona was coming down to Petty and Waltrip.
Waltrip trying to slingshot. Petty is out in front at the line. Waltrip slingshot. Petty wins it.
Petty has won his sixth Daytona 500, and the crowd here are going absolutely mad.
From our perspective, this was amazingly good press. The king of NASCAR, Richard Petty, wins the first 500-mile race that's telecast live in its entirety.
Here comes a $60,000 car becoming a 22-passenger school bus.
Just weeks earlier, Petty had been on an operating table. Now, he was headed to victory lane.
I've looked into some races. That's probably one I've looked into as much as any race.
So Petty is coming down victory lane, and you know our handhelds are ready to do the interviews and to do the celebration and the hugging and the kissing and all that.
One of the things that we had to do was we had to promise Goodyear that we would say these pictures are being brought to you and being taken from the Goodyear blimp.
And Michael Pearl never even looked. He said, go to the blimp.
The next thing we know, we look up, and there's this fist fight going on.
And there's a fight between Cale Yarborough and Donnie Allison. The tempers overflowing.
I was pretty hot. He cost me a chance of winning another Daytona 500.
And Bobby Allison is stopped by his brother to help. There's Bobby Allison's car, number 15.
Cale was a tough guy, but Cale did not want any piece of Donnie Allison. And so here I was, the ideal chance for him to yell at somebody. Cale started yelling that the wreck was my fault. He hit me in the face with his helmet.
So I ran and grabbed him by the arm, and I spun him around. And I said, if you want to fight, you SOB, I'm the guy you'd be fighting with.
So I figured it was going to be a double teaming, so so we went at it for a little while.
And as the brawl played out live on television, up in the tower, the mood quickly changed.
I remember looking at it and thinking, oh no, this is not good. This is not the way we wanted to introduce our sport to the country at large.
In sports today, the top story is auto racing, and here's Al Ackerman to tell us about it. Al?
Well, Sam, Hollywood obviously scripted today's race, and then they threw the story away because nobody believed it would happen.
Petty is out in front at the line. Walter, Petty wins it. The hopes for Donnie Allison vanish. Cale Yarborough trying to win his third. He's out of it.
It was front page. Everybody was talking about it. They were talking about it in Connecticut. They were talking about it in New York. They were talking about it in California. Did you guys see this sport called NASCAR? Did you watch this thing yesterday?
Today's Daytona 500 wraps the premier stock car race, produced an incredibly dramatic finish and an explosion of tempers.
And there's a fight between Cale Yarborough and Donnie Allison. The tempers overflowing. They're angry. They know they have lost. And what a bitter defeat.
Whether you picked up the Charlotte Observer or the New York Times, it was all about the Daytona 500 and the fight.
People watched that race that had never watched a race before in their life, and they said, hey, this is pretty cool.
And now they sit there and they say, you know what? I'm going to watch that next race.
Back at Daytona that Sunday, as the credits rolled, the TV crew didn't know yet that 15.1 million people had watched the race, winning the afternoon for CBS. But they did have a sense already. They'd changed a sport forever.
There was a lot of hugging, there was a lot of handshaking, and I think that everybody knew that they were part of something special.
For NASCAR's first flag-to-flag coverage, I mean, you couldn't have paid for it.
Penn
pandemonium here in Victory Lane. Back to you, Ken.
100,000 people can't believe what they've just seen.
Mike Pearl walked up in tears.
For some reason, I really felt we nailed it.
He knew, because he knows good television. He knew what had been accomplished.
The TV crew was headed home. But the next morning in Daytona, Bill France Jr. had a tape to watch to help him make a decision about the fight heard round the sports world.
Bill Jr. leans back in his chair and he says, I don't believe we really need to do a lot. While you had to find the drivers, while you had to put them on probation, Bill Jr. knew that you didn't have to come down with a giant hammer on them. They were part of the reason why NASCAR was center stage.
They fined Cale, Bobby, and myself $6,000 apiece, and they put Bobby and I on probation, but not Cale.
My prize money was $4,000, so we had to cough up that $2,000 check. Still haven't gotten it back.
Ken Squire hadn't figured on a fight capping the 500, but the day did bear out what he'd sold.
I think this vindicated everything Ken did to push CBS to do this live. His passion for the sport, realizing that this was a big stage event worthy of having national exposure.
It was just the start of an award-winning run for CBS and the launching point of a new era for NASCAR on TV.
We gradually increased the number of races. A number of new channels came on stream and saw that we were having success. And over the next 10, 12 years, they began covering races. That exposure helped to grow the sport.
I saw the evolution of NASCAR racing while I was president. That really changed it from, I'd say, a regional attraction to an adoption by the rest of the nation for the same attributes or characteristics that had made it endeared to the people in the South.
There would be other great NASCAR races in the years to come, other unforgettable characters who emerged as the sport took its place amid the wide-ranging collection of history and culture that will always make up America. But for the little sport of NASCAR to take its improbable place on that stage, it took nothing less than a perfect storm. As I walk through this wicked world, searching for light in the darkness of insanity.
Billions of dollars are given as rights fees to NASCAR races, and it all started with that 79 Daytona 500.
It was a huge success. It was a landmark telecast.
I still watch that race today, and it's like one of your favorite movies.
In order for people to remember something, there has to be a wow moment.
And there's a fight!
We did what we set out to do. People seem to enjoy it. So what's better than that?
The next time you sit down to watch a race, think about how it all started, about how much has changed, and about how much will always stay the same.